Hey buddy, today we'll be compiling a kernel from source. A kernel is a piece of software that directly controls the hardware and does some basic functions like file management, memory management, processor multitasking, and much more. Every operating system has one. The Linux kernel is open source, meaning anyone can view, modify, and publish its source code. In this video, we will download the Linux kernel's source code and compile it on our own computer. Not everyone needs to compile Linux kernel from source code. If you are a computer enthusiast like me, then you can do this for learning or just for fun. If you are a developer, you might be searching for a bug to help the Linux community. You may also be compiling the Linux kernel because you've got some new hardware that isn't supported by your distribution yet. In case our custom-built kernel fails to start, we need some time to select the stock kernel that came with the distribution in the grub boot menu. In the description below, you can find links for increasing timeout for Lilo, Berg, and Syslinux if you're not using grub as your bootloader. Because Debian and Ubuntu use grub as its default bootloader, let's increase the timeout for it. To get started, open a terminal and run the command sudo nano /etc/default/grub. I am using nano because it is the easiest. You can use a text editor of your choice. Here, as you can see, the grub timeout is set to only 5 seconds. We want to increase that timeout to 10 seconds so we have plenty of time to select a different kernel. With that, also make sure to comment out grub hidden timeout and grub hidden timeout quiet. If they don't already exist in the file, then you need not make any modifications other than increasing the grub timeout to 10. One other thing is to make sure grub timeout is not commented out. Once the necessary changes have been made, press Ctrl plus O to save the file and then press Ctrl plus X to exit out of nano. Now that we have updated our grub bootloader's configuration, we have to rebuild our initial RAM file system to contain the bootloader with the newest configuration. To do that, run the command sudo update-grub. This will rebuild the initial RAM file system, so when we reboot after installing the compiled kernel, the changes are applied to grub. To check what version of Linux kernel is currently running on any Linux distribution, run the command uname-r to just show the kernel version, or uname-a to show everything about the kernel. As you can see, we're running the Linux kernel 5.3.0. The next thing would be to download the kernel source code, so let's close the terminal and open an internet browser. Now head over to kernel.org, as that is a good place where we can download the kernel source from. If you intend to compile the kernel, which is under development, you can also directly clone the kernel source from its Git repository, but obsolete and under development kernels can be extremely unstable. For this video, let's download Linux kernel 5.4.1, which is the latest stable at the time of making this video. To download, click on the tarball link. Your internet browser may or may not ask you where to save the file. If asked, save it in a directory which is empty. I'll save it in the downloads folder itself. So the source code is around 104 megabytes when compressed. As we have now downloaded the kernel source code, let's close the internet browser and reopen the terminal. Here, navigate to the directory where you have downloaded the kernel. As you can see, we downloaded a tar.exe file which is highly compressed. First, we need to extract the source code from this archive. We will make a directory using the command mkdir linux underscore kernel. To start the extraction, let's run the command tar xvf linux -tar -c linux_kernel --strip-components=1. This will extract the downloaded kernel archive into the linux underscore kernel directory that we just made. To increase the extraction speed, you can remove the v in the tar xvf part of the command. As the extraction process has been finished, we will enter the linux underscore kernel directory we created. So this is how the source code of a kernel looks like. Running the command du-sh tells us that the extracted source is around 1 gigabyte. Now that we have the source code for the kernel that we are going to compile, the next thing to do is installing dependency software packages that are required to compile the Linux kernel on Ubuntu or Debian. Note that they might differ a little bit depending on whether you want to compile on Ubuntu or Debian. To install those dependency software packages on Debian, run the command sudo apt install build-essential rsync gcc bc bison flex libssl-dev libncursusfy-dev libelf-dev. . When asked whether to continue, press the Y key on your keyboard. Build Essential is a group of software packages that will install the required tools for compilation. Rsync is a data backup and transfer utility. GCC is the GNU C compiler, which actually compiles C code. BC is an extension to GCC. Bison is a parser. Flex is a lexical analyzer. libssl-dev is the development package for OpenSSL. libncursusfy-dev is the development package for ncurses. And finally, libelf-dev is the library for reading ELF files. If you don't know about all these packages and what they do, just know that they need to be installed before you can successfully compile the Linux kernel. The last thing to do before we start compiling the Linux kernel on Ubuntu and Debian is to create a config file that tells which modules, components, and drivers should be included in the compiled kernel. To do that, there are two ways, and each way has its drawbacks and plus points. The first method to configure the kernel compilation is to copy the config file that came with your distribution of Linux. To do that, on an Ubuntu or Debian-based system, run the command cp /boot /config -$uname -r --config. This will copy the config file of the currently running kernel that came from your distribution of Linux. The kernel from your Linux distribution comes with a lot of drivers and modules. This is to support a wide range of hardware. The advantage of copying the config file of the kernel from your distribution is to retain the support for a wide range of hardware. Although it'll take a long time to compile all those drivers and modules where we don't require majority of them to run your computer. The second method is to generate a config file based on the currently connected hardware of your computer. To do that, run the command make local mod config. This will ask you questions on whether to enable a kernel module or not. Keep pressing the enter key until all prompts have been answered. If you know what each module is about, you can take your time to answer these prompts. Once the process is done, we are now ready to start the compilation process. The compilation can be done by a single core of your processor or use multiple cores. It is recommended to stick with a single core, even though it takes longer. Sometimes the compilation process may break when using multiple cores. To start the compilation process, run the command make deb-pkg. If you still want to compile the Linux kernel using multiple cores, then run the command make-j followed by the number of processor cores you want to compile with deb-pkg. For example, if you want to compile the kernel using 4 cores, you can run the command make-j4 deb-pkg. Using the second method, that is generating the config file from your connected hardware, takes much less time to compile the kernel, as only the modules and drivers that are required for your system are compiled into the kernel, resulting in a smaller kernel which is quicker to load, which reduces your kernel overhead. One major drawback is that the kernel will have no idea of any new hardware that you will connect in the future. If you don't frequently connect new hardware like printers, cameras, and other devices, using only the required drivers will slightly improve the performance. The kernel should be freshly compiled in case you get some new hardware to include the drivers for that hardware. So I don't want to waste your time. Let me fast forward until the kernel has finished compiling. So on AMD Ryzen 2200G with 4 GB of RAM on a VirtualBox virtual machine, the compilation took just over 30 minutes. Once the compilation process finished, you should get Debian deb packages in the parent directory. To install them, let's go a directory back and run the command sudo dpkg-i linux-star.deb to install all Debian packages, and the installation for the newly compiled kernel will start. Once the installation is done, dpkg will automatically rebuild the initial RAM file system. Note that this might take a minute or so. Now that we have installed a newly compiled kernel, let's try booting into it. To reboot the computer, run the command sudo shutdown-r now. As I compiled and installed the new kernel on the same computer I'm recording from, let me come back after I reboot. Now let's open the terminal once again and check if we are running the newly compiled kernel. Let's run the uname-r command. So there we go, we have successfully compiled the Linux kernel from source code on Debian or Ubuntu. I was planning to make this video for a year and had written an article on my previous website too. I will link that article in the description, but this video contains some improvements than that article. So that was it for this video. Please subscribe and hit the bell icon for more videos like this. This is Vasant Developer signing off.